to be right. I think about it day and night. I feel like a king, oh yeah. And baby, can't help but stare. Such a rush, baby. I want you to touch me, baby. Such a rush, baby.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. You're listening to Viva ENT. This is Johnny the Capo. I'm here live in Seattle with my co-host,
the infamous Becka Page. Good afternoon, everybody.
I like infamous. That's a good way to describe you. And my most excellent producer, Mr.
Eric C.C. Ryder. Good afternoon and happy Thursday.
Happy Thursday to you. Happy pre-storm.
Yes.
You know what's going on with this? I did a rain dance praying that the cure is going to go to Sasquatch. And after this storm, we will see. I'm super excited.
All right.
You know, I just...
They're touring with one of my favorite bands, by the way, the Twilight Sad. So
I don't know them.
You got to check them out. They're pretty darn amazing.
I will. I know when they opened for the Wish Tour with the Cranes, that was... I'm an eternal Cranes fan now. So... Johnny's like, I have no idea what you guys are talking about.
Back to Elvis.
And
this is Viva ENT, after all. It's
featuring
all about
Johnny,
yeah,
the Capo.
But I like what you're talking about, and I'm into what you're talking about, and I'm slightly familiar with what you're talking about.
They've been around since 1976.
Well, I've been around
so
at least
if you don't
that
know,
long.
If you don't know The Cure, you are lacking in music.
Oh, I like
music.
The Cure.
You do like The Cure. Every time I play
like,
The Cure, mm-hmm. you think that Robert Smith is a badass guitarist.
I
so,
do.
You
yes,
do.
I like him. And tell me more what's happening with them.
Well, they're doing a 2016 North American tour, which is huge. And... they just released the dates already. The tickets that have gone on sale sold out instantly all over the nation. And they just added a new tour, which is Seattle, because I was super sad they weren't coming.
That's my question.
And they're saying it's going to be Sasquatch, hopefully.
In the where's the Sasquatch?
It's at the Gorge.
Right.
And so that's going to be an epic show. I mean, how many people can fit out at the Gorge?
Quite a lot.
It'll be sold out. I guarantee you.
80,000? 100,000?
I thought it was
Sasquatch
60, 80.
Seems to sell out every year, doesn't it?
Yeah. But I mean, seeing The Cure in with 80,000 people, it's going to be epic. I've already blocked that weekend. I'm not doing any weddings that weekend.
Yeah. Huh?
I will be worshiping at Sasquatch. So
Wow. That's
the rain dance, folks. So I'm really sorry about the 50-mile-an-hour winds and the floods, but let's pray for The Cure.
Now, hold on.
I'm not sure how those two things are related.
I did a rain dance.
Right.
Now, let me get this straight, though. Sasquatch, isn't that in August?
No.
Yes.
May. March, May.
Memorial Day weekend, yeah.
May. Yes.
Sounds like you're probably in the clear to go.
Oh, I've already blocked it.
Yeah,
ain't no one stopping me.
Ain't no stopping us now.
Yeah.
I didn't know that rain dances could also be applied to booking shows.
Absolutely.
But, we learn something new on the show every week.
That's right.
We do all kinds of stuff to book shows, trust me. But anyway, let's get back to the basics of what's going on with Viva ENT today. And
You just flew in from Vegas, so you're a little...
I just flew in from Vegas.
Now. He just got here.
Yeah, so. Just got off the plane.
Still
having
a little,
some Vegas nights, if you will.
He is. He's still having a little spinnies going on.
No, I'm actually pretty cool.
Cool.
I'll tell you about the Vegas thing, but let's talk about today's guest, first of all.
Because it's an absolute honor for you to have this guest on.
That's correct. And, you know, we have Terry and Mike Jeffery on today. We're going to be calling him about 3:30.
Uh-huh.
And he is a unique person. He's big in the Elvis world, and he's not an impersonator per se,
mm-hmm.
but he does an Elvis tribute show. And he doesn't dress up like Elvis, doesn't try to shake like Elvis, but he definitely delivers the songs, you know, without any question. You just heard a little bit of it a moment ago.
Yeah, we're going to play one of his recordings a little bit later.
Trying to get to you. It's pretty convincing.
Hmm.
I want to talk about last week's...
Coming from you, that's huge.
Well, let me tell you...
I've shown Johnny some of the world's best Elvis impersonators, and he's just like, meh. And so for him to say that...
I like the real good ones when they portray Elvis, you know, in his peak. I don't like some of the older... some of them I don't like. But before we go any further, I want to... Say, what a rush it was last week to have Mike Stoller on the show.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about it, Eric.
That was pretty amazing.
That was pretty
legendary songwriter.
Oh, my God.
Boy, more scoops in that. You know, there's always, like, stuff that I've never heard anywhere else, you know, and I like to consider myself pretty well-versed with rock and roll history, just like you, just like Jerry. And, you know, there's definitely some stuff in there in that interview that I don't think most people knew.
Thought about.
Well, we have a lot of fun interviewing our guests, too. We try to ask them a lot of questions that other people just don't ask.
Right.
In a lot of interviews, you'll always hear them ask the same questions over and over, and that's kind of what gets written in the history books. But, you know, some of the scoops we've gotten on the show have just been jaw-dropping. Like,
you know, a lot of people know Lieber and Stoller were legendary songwriting team, you know, the Lenny McCartney of their time, whatever. Any songwriting team, they stack up to it for sure. So many big, big songs. But, you know, I never heard it broken down on who did what with Lieber and Stoller.
Yeah.
So to find out that Stoller was the guy writing all the music and Lieber was the guy writing the lyrics was pretty darn interesting to me, you know? And they, of course, collaborated on those two things, but I didn't know how it broke down before that. So, you know, that's a little scoop.
And, you know, not only that, Eric, I didn't either. I always wondered all these years who did what, you know, just like you just broke it down. And, you know, when he broke it down for us, I mean, that was like a scoop.
Yeah. And we found out that he was playing piano in Jailhouse Rock in the movie.
Mike Stoller is in the Treat Me Nice scene.
Yeah.
When they were in the studio recording Treat Me Nice, Mike Stoller is at the piano.
So who are the other artists that he's written songs for that have become huge hits?
Drifters, Coasters, Jane and the Americans, It's so many. They had 71 top 10.
Okay, so the question I wish I could ask, and if he comes back on, which he said he would,
we will.
That I would like to ask him is, I was thinking about when he was talking about getting off the boat and finding out that this young kid named Elvis Presley had this huge song, right? And he's just like, he didn't know who it was. So the question I wanted to ask him is, what one song did you write and it went to, like, the artist that you wanted that song to be sung by, and it's just like your favorite one, the one you're most proud of?
Well,
because it can't be Elvis, because he didn't know who Elvis was when, you know, they just bought the song and did it.
Yeah, that was when Hound Dog came out. But he talked about Mama Thornton.
Big Mama Thornton.
Big Mama Thornton doing Hound Dog before Elvis, and him actually preferring that version of the song. Mm. And they kind of wrote it with her in mind, I think. So
And then they said the last song was the Peggy Lee song, Is That All There Is?
Uh-huh.
Now, here's my analogy of that. Big Mama Thornton, Hound Dog, is just totally my opinion, was the first song that for them that they actually got a recognition. They made a record, it was on the radio, you know in the stations that they would play it. And then Is That All There Is, I think, was probably their last hit, which was like 1969 ish so that's probably the first and the last, and I think that was special to him. That's what I'm thinking. What do you think?
You could be right.
Yeah.
We'll have to confirm that next time he's on the show. I also didn't know that he was in a shipwreck. I mean, that was pretty amazing, as you mentioned.
Oh, You
mentioned Hound Dog, like him not knowing about it. Well, it was because he was in a shipwreck.
Yeah, what was that?
That's pretty interesting slice of history right there.
Do you remember the name of the ship? It was the something.
Yeah. The name of it is slipping my mind at the moment. But
if you say the name, you know you heard of it.
Yes.
Exactly. Okay, cool. So now I got a major announcement, Becca Page. Can you give me a drum roll on the...
Ding!
I should have asked Eric for a drum roll.
Okay.
So, drum roll. Ladies and gentlemen, if you listen to our show, Viva ENT, you know we cover rock and roll celebrities every week, thanks to our buddy Jerry Osborne. And, you know, last week we had Mike Stoller on, who I thought was the peak of all peaks. I really did. But the first Thursday in December, I'm not sure the date, but the first Thursday in December, Elvis Presley's original drummer, DJ Fontana, will be on our show. Can you believe that? Can you believe that?
I can't. I just can't.
That's pretty cool.
I can't believe it.
Hey, Johnny, why don't you just say that one more time just to let me see you be tickled? Do it.
Okay. The original drummer for Mr. Elvis Presley from 1954. That's All Right, Mama, right up through the movie years and even the 68 comeback special. DJ Fontana will be our guest on Viva ENT.
For real. He's not even lying.
Pretty cool.
I wish I was lying.
That's really cool, Johnny.
Yeah.
So it was the Andrea Doria.
Is that something else?
Yeah, that was the ship that Mike Stoller was on.
Ain't that something? That was a great story, and man. A word from our sponsors, and then we're going to come back, folks.
And what are we
going
to talk about real quick?
We're going to talk about Terry and Mike and
the song of the week. We'll be right back, folks.
Attention business owners, experience a new world of business with barter. The Saturn Barter Company, located in Tacoma, is one of the most beneficial business decisions you can make. Using Saturn Barter, you are able to sell your products or services to other members of the exchange. You can then use that credit you've built up from your sales to purchase the products or services you or your company needs from other companies within Saturn Barter, all without the use of cash. Contact and join Saturn Barter Club today, 253-212-9930, or online at SaturnBarter.com.
Is your vehicle needing some attention? Take it over to Maddie's Tuning and Shoreline for fast, affordable car care. Trusted, professional, Maddie's services all makes and models and has been trusted in the Puget Sound for almost 60 years. Call Brian Maddie at 206-364-3347 or stop by his convenient location in Shoreline right on Aurora at 152nd. Maddie's Tuning. Call 206-364-3347. Trusted for almost 60 years to keep you safe and on the road. It's frustrating when your car won't start or just won't go. Or you're locked out of your car and need to be somewhere. All Day Towing will take the frustration out of the situation with 24-hour service 7 days a week. They'll tow your vehicle safely to where it needs to go. Plus, they strive to reach you within 25 minutes of your call. When you need a tow, call All Day Towing at 206-695-2615. Or 425-457-7788 for Eastside customers. All Day Towing. We'll be there. We promise.
Brides, do you want your big day to be stress-free, perfect, and stay within your budget? Well, Brides Club has all the inside information to make your dream a reality. Go to bridesclub.com. That's bridesclub.com. See upcoming bridal shows and events, view wedding vendors and special offers. And don't miss The Spotlight, the premier online wedding magazine with valuable articles you can't afford to miss. Brides Club helps make your wedding stress-free and perfect. Go to bridesclub.com. Check out bridesclub.com.
Life's a celebration. Grand Event Rentals makes your event their top priority. They are your full-service, special event, and party rental provider, supplying everything you need from start to finish. Their professional sales team and event staff work with you to create your dream event. With every event, Grand Event Rentals customers' needs are the most important. Whether you're planning an intimate outdoor wedding or an elaborate black tie gala, the Grand Event Rentals specialists make great pride in providing our event planning experience to help create an unforgettable event. Please go and visit the Bellevue Showroom, Grand Event Rentals, or make a one-on-one appointment. Talk to them. They're trained, they're knowledgeable, they're event specialists, and they are going to take you through step-by-step everything that you need to make your day a success. Call Grand Event Rentals. Their number is 425-462-7368, or go to grandeventrentalswa.com.
Proud to bring variety to your radio dial. Alternative Talk, 1150 AM.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Viva ENT. This is Johnny the Capo. I'm in the studio with Becka Page, Eric CC Ryder, and you know what? I want to get right to it. I usually let them say hi, but not today.
Why?
Well, because I want to get right to it.
Why?
I want to talk about
this is the infamous Becca Page with our producer.
Okay. Hello, I'm Eric C.C. Ryder, and we're going to play some tunes, right?
Well, yes. Which one are we going to play first, Eric?
Well, what do you prefer?
Well, let's talk about the bridge over troubled water. I forgot to tell you? I wanted the Royal
with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. Band. This is the new album that's come out now. That's got the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra accompanying Elvis. Obviously, older recordings of Elvis's vocals, but put together, it's pretty impressive.
And the good thing is, it just charted. I think it's number one in the UK.
Wow.
Yeah. And it's just charted, and it just sold a bunch of albums. So anyway. I want to talk about Bridge Over Troubled Water because it was the number one song of 1970 by Simon and Garfunkel.
Mm-hmm.
It was a great song. Art Garfunkel sang the lead. It was also the beginning of their end, Simon and Garfunkel, too.
Hmm.
I'll tell you about that, too. Yeah. It went to Art's head.
There was some troubled water there.
There was some troubled water.
Couldn't quite get over, apparently.
When Paul's doing all the stuff.
Yeah.
Anyway, and the song, it was a great song. Art Garfunkel took it to number one. He did a good job on it. But Elvis's version, when Elvis came back to perform in 1969 and 1970, live on stage, there were singers out there at the time, like Engelbert Humperdinck and Tom Jones, that were really nailing those notes. You know, those high notes and just... And Elvis didn't want to be a relic, you know, making all those movies, got all the bad publicity from the movies. DJs weren't playing his songs on the radio no more. He wanted to prove himself as a contemporary artist. He wanted to show people that, hey, I can hit the high notes just like anybody else. So this performance, not necessarily a live performance. I'm sure they cut it in the studio because it's so perfect. But... as a matter of fact, I'm wrong. This is a different performance I've never heard. So play it.
All right.
Oh my gosh. Like it.
When you're weary, feeling small, when tears are in your eyes, I would dry them all. I'm on your side. Oh, it's rough, and friends just can't be found like a bridge over troubled water. I will lay me down like a bridge over troubled water. I will lay me down
dreams are on their way. See how they shine. Oh.
Well, I'll be damned.
I'm blown away, man.
That was beautiful.
That's the first time I heard that.
That's beautiful.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
I believe that the album is the number one classical album in the country right now. Just, I think it's number one in the UK. You could check the stats.
That was gorgeous.
But that arrangement and the Royal Phil Harmonica.
Harmonic.
Oh, pardon me, sir.
Philharmonic Orchestra. That's right.
Oh, the Royal Philharmonic. I mean, can you say it?
Royal Philharmonic Orchestra.
Okay, that's what's going on.
I was shaking.
That was Paige.
Yes.
Tell me the truth.
It was amazing.
Tell me the truth. Oh my God.
That was really beautiful.
Oh my man. Oh man. Oh man. That was. I can't get over it.
Kind of like when the general public heard "Hello" by Adele for the first time and. Did you know? Okay, Adele hasn't had an album out in a while.
I like Adele.
When she came out, released "Hello" with the music video.
Yeah, "Hello, I love you. Won't you tell me your name?"
Over 27 million hits the first day it was released.
"Hello."
Yeah, by Adele.
How's it go?
I'm not even going to attempt to sing Adele. Heck no.
Well, I'm listening.
But anyway, the song right now is number one. It's ridiculous.
Right now, this
you haven't heard "Hello" by Adele?
Are they playing on Top 40 radio?
Like every other song?
Boy, I tell you, I'm feeling old or something.
It's beautiful. Oh. There's even a meme that says Adele came out with a new song, and it's just someone handing her a Grammy. Like she's so amazing.
Yeah.
Do you like her?
I do. Yeah, I think she's a great talent.
Very gifted. Yeah. So then there's all this stuff going around. Like Ellen did a farce on it because ever since she came out with "Hello," I've had Lionel Richie's "Hello" in my head. So I'll show it to you. There's a little video of him going "Hello," and then she answers the phone with her song "Hello," and he's like, "Is it me you're looking for?" And she like slams the phone down. It's awesome.
Well, the "Hello" that I have in my mind is "Hello." I love you. Won't you tell me
your name?
That's
funny.
That's the one
that's
in my mind.
I wanted to. Can I say something here?
Sure. Well, go ahead.
Just because you know, Viva Productions is a large entertainment company, and one of the main things we do that's huge with us is the wedding DJ industry.
Of course.
And we've done hundreds of weddings, and you know, sometimes I actually do become very good friends with the brides and grooms, and it continues.
You do.
After that, I have several close friends that I did their wedding and we just instantly bonded, and I have some other ones that I've just been meaning to get in touch with. But a few years ago, I did my and Mike Penn's wedding, and it was one of the most fun weddings I ever did. That's where I met Bobby and Amy Tatishi with the Anchored Memories.
With the video?
So anyway, I just wanted to announce that some of my brides and grooms have baby madness going on. Maya Mike Penn just delivered Malachi. They took him home today, and he is the freaking cutest baby I've ever seen in my life. Nate and Heather Morales, their baby, I did their wedding last year. Their baby's due 6 of 16. And Corey and Christina Jelvik, which was another just, these are all my favorite weddings. Their baby is going to be due April 2016.
Wow.
So congratulations. And I have more brides that are pregnant, but I'll announce that next week.
Quick word from our sponsors, folks.
Thanks.
Hi, everybody. This is Johnny from Viva Productions. I want to tell you a little bit about Vegas Nights. Forget about Vegas. I brought casino tables to the Emerald City. Craps, blackjack, roulette, poker. If you're planning a private party, corporate party, senior grad party, any kind of party, you want casino tables, you call 206-542-542. 5733. Vegas Nights, that's right, shake, rattle, and roll.
Brides, do you want your big day to be stress-free, perfect, and stay within your budget? Well, Brides Club has all the inside information to make your dream a reality. Go to bridesclub.com, that's bridesclub.com. See upcoming bridal shows and events, view wedding vendors and special offers. And don't miss The Spotlight, the premier online wedding magazine with valuable articles you can't afford to miss. Brides Club helps make your wedding stress-free and perfect. Go to bridesclub.com, check out bridesclub.com.
Attention business owners. Experience a new world of business with barter. The Saturn Barter Company, located in Tacoma, is one of the most beneficial business decisions you can make. Using Saturn Barter, you are able to sell your products or services to other members of the exchange. You can then use that credit you've built up from your sales to purchase the products or services you or your company needs from other companies within Saturn Barter, all without the use of cash. Contact and join Saturn Barter Club today, 253-212-9930, or online at SaturnBarter.com.
Is your vehicle needing some attention? Take it over to Maddie's Tuning and Shoreline for fast, affordable car care. Trusted, professional, Maddie's services all makes and models and has been trusted in the Puget Sound for almost 60 years. Call Brian Maddie at 206-364-3347 or stop by his convenient location in Shoreline right on Aurora at 152nd. Maddie's Tuning. Call 206-364-3347. Trusted for almost 60 years to keep you safe and on the road.
News, traffic, and weather? Now you can get your information fixed weekdays on Alternative Talk, 1150 AM.
Okay, Terry, I know you recognize that music. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Viva ENT. We're live in Seattle. I have good buddy Jerry Osborne on, of course, and our special guest today is Terry Mike Jeffery. Terry, say hi.
Hey, good to be on the air with you guys.
Well, you know, we got you live on the air in Seattle, and, you know, it's such a pleasure to have you on the show. I listen to Elvis Radio all the time, so I've heard lots and lots and lots of your interviews, and I know that you guest DJ there from time to time. Heard you sing live, you know, playing the guitar and stuff.
So
I got a real good knowledge about who you are, what you do. I'm really ecstatic, you know, that you're a tribute artist and not necessarily a impersonator, which I respect a lot. And Jerry's on the line. And Jerry, would you chime in and let's get.
Well, you know, I'm not familiar with this guy you're having on. Who the heck is he?
long time Jerry Osborne and I have known each other.
You know what, Terry? I have on my desk right now a letter from an address on Roof Drive, Route 4, Kenneview Estates. Does that sound familiar?
It does, Jerry, and I haven't lived there in 28 years.
Oh, well, it was 37
that's
years.
That's a pretty old letter.
It was 37 years ago you first wrote me from that address, and I still have it. It's one of my most cherished collectibles.
is that right?
Yeah,
really?
I got it right here. It says, Jerry, I am an entertainer, singer, and was a friend of Elvis. Charlie Hodge is my personal manager under contract, blah, 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 yada, yada, yada. See, I got it right here.
Wow. Now, you know what? You're going to have to bring that to Memphis next time you're there. I'd like to just look at that.
I will scan it and email it to you.
That is even better.
Then you'll have it right away.
I would love to see that. That's, wow, that's going back quite a ways. Like I said, I haven't lived at that address in 28 years, but when I was there, I was there 13 years, so that's been a long time.
Well, I got you.
And you mentioning Charlie Hodge being my manager, that had to be, Jerry, 78, 79,
it was
somewhere
78,
in there.
I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I also want to say that I have emceed many shows where Terry Mike Jeffery was either the headliner or one of the headliners,
right,
and most all of those shows were in Memphis, but I want to tell you that this guy has never, never failed to put on a fantastic show, and people who don't know about him need to know that he is the world's top Elvis tribute artist, and that is my opinion. And, of course, I'm right because I'm Mr. Rock and Roll. And, so, you know, there's the build-up that I have for you, Terry.
You know what's funny about that, Jerry? I've never done the impersonator thing at all. You know that.
Of course.
I've never dyed my hair or done the moves or worn the jumpsuit and all that. But you know what's funny is when Charlie Hodge first started managing me, it was to do an Elvis tribute show, and it was to present Elvis's music as authentically as possible, and with Charlie on stage with me and my band, and just try to make it authentic but not impersonate him.
Correct.
At that time, in the late 70s, the guys that were out there doing the impersonator thing, they were literally called Elvis impersonators.
Correct.
Well, Charlie Hodge tried to come up with a title for what exactly it is that I am, and he came up with Elvis Tribute Artist.
Yeah, I like
that.
Isn't
that funny?
Yeah.
Because years later, the impersonators didn't like the word impersonator, so they came up with Elvis Tribute Artist. After that, I thought, well, you know, I'm not sure what I am. If I'm not an Elvis Tribute Artist, because that's an impersonator, I'm not sure what to call me.
Well,
then Ronnie Tutt came up with, I don't really use this term, but Ronnie Tutt refers to me as an Elvis interpreter.
Cool.
So I guess that's just another way to put it, you know.
Well, the way that I look at it, and this is Johnny. I'm the host of Viva ENT.
Hey, Johnny.
Terry, it's a pleasure to have you on the show. I'm from Las Vegas, and I remember the very first real. I don't want to say the word real, but Dick Clark brought Alan to Las Vegas.
I remember Alan.
Okay, now
I thought he was great.
I did too. I was dealing craps at the Thunderbird Hotel when Dick Clark brought Alan in to the Thunderbird to do his tribute show.
Uh-huh.
Now, so I stood in the side and I watched Alan, and I thought he did a great job, especially the young Elvis with the sun years and so on and so forth, and I liked him. I won't say that I loved him, but I liked him. And then I was there when when Elvis passed, Johnny Hara came in.
Uh-huh.
And then, I first saw Johnny Hara at a downtown casino, and of course he resembled Elvis towards the end of his career.
He did.
No question about it. Not facially to the max, but vocally, he did great. And then in the next couple of weeks, Johnny Hara went from downtown lounge to the showroom on the Las Vegas Strip. That's how popular Elvis impersonators were. And that and that's the term, Elvis impersonators. I suppose that's the term. Now you, I'm a big Elvis fan, always have been. I'm from Vegas. I seen Elvis in 1969 at the International, and many, many, many times when he performed in Vegas.
Uh-huh.
I really think that the term for you, sir, and I say this with all due respect, I think I love Elvis Tribute Artist. I really think that nails you to the T. Because,
well, thank you.
Because
thank you.
The impersonators, it's different. They're impersonators. They're out there doing the thing. Now, myself, I'm a musician, guitar player, singer. I played all the Vegas lounge acts. And last August, here in Seattle, I got the idea by thinking about you of, I can sing the Elvis songs. I play lead guitar and all that stuff. I just wanted to do a show where people heard the music.
Right.
And I could shake my leg and I could wear the white jumpsuit. And so could you, if you wanted to. But I really think the music has been really hidden from the general public, because Elvis doesn't get his due as far as being a creative artist, and he was.
He absolutely was.
Yeah.
He Elvis, as you know, I'm sure, he was basically in charge of his recording sessions.
Oh yeah, especially Hound Dog.
A lot of people got credit for being the producer, Felton Jarvis,
right.
Chet Atkins, Steve Scholes, they all got credit for being a producer, and I think they served their purpose
right.
fine, but really, the guy who called the shots, picked the songs, picked the takes that would be used was Elvis.
That's right.
The get-go, from the beginning.
Yeah, he was a producer.
You know, a lot of artists will not do that. They'll leave that up to their producer. But yeah. It's funny, Johnny, that you mention August of 1969.
Oh, here it comes.
I was there, man.
No, but listen to what Terry has to say.
I love to.
When I was 15, I got to see Elvis for the first time, and it was on August 1st, 1969. And as you know, July 31st was the opening night invited guest only show.
Correct.
And so I couldn't get into that one, but I got in on August 1st, and I saw both shows that night, and I snuck backstage between shows and got to meet him and have pictures made with him. And I got to tell you, everything you've ever heard about how nice a guy he is absolutely true.
Yeah.
And just I couldn't believe how much time he took to talk to me. He could have spoken very quickly and, yeah, here's an autograph and see you later. But he did not. He spent absolute let me put it this way. I was overwhelmed with how he treated me.
Yeah.
I was 15. I was a kid. He just was genuinely as nice a man as I have ever met in my life.
Yeah.
And,
Are you trying to say that had an effect on your life?
What's that?
Are you trying to say that had an effect on your life?
It absolutely, positively did. Absolutely.
Wow. You know, I think that if
someone as big as Elvis Presley, and they don't get any bigger star than him, if he can be that nice to people, I can't imagine anybody that's not as big a star not being that nice. You know, that they I guess that sort of imprinted in me, you know, always be nice to people.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter how big you are, you know, always try to be really nice to people and treat them with, you know, respect. And he did that. And you hear that from other people, too. I'm not the only one that you're hearing that from.
Of course.
There are people who have met Elvis and how nice and genuine he was. But I got to see him several times in Las Vegas. I went back twice in 72 in February and August. I went again right after my wife and I got married. We went out there in August of 73. I saw him in, let me think, 74 I did not, 75. I had reservations in August of 75, but it was during the time that he had canceled.
Yeah.
But I did see him the final time in December of 76 in Las Vegas. I loved the Las Vegas Hilton. I loved the International Hotel.
Yeah, I think...
And I got to know so many of the captains and Emilio and, gosh, I can't remember all the names, but I got to know some of those guys pretty well from being out there as many times as I did get to go.
Sure.
I'm pretty sure that, and we can check on this, but I think the last time Elvis performed at the Hilton was February 1977. Could be wrong, but I'm going to check that stat. But
I think it was December of 76.
Okay.
Yeah, it was.
Was it really?
He did tour in February of 77.
Oh, yeah. Sure.
Well, actually, rock historians, Elvis played Vegas February and August all those years. He never really played December in Vegas. I could be wrong, but I'll check the stat.
But he did in 76.
Could be.
He was there in December of 76.
And 76 both in December.
And I was there, too.
Could be.
And those, I'll tell you how that came about. When he had to cancel, he did I think two nights in August of 75, and then he was sick, and he had to cancel the rest of the month or the 2 weeks. I can't remember which it was. And to make up for that date, they had him come in December of 75.
So
they turned it into a Christmas celebration. And so the next year in 76, they had him come back in December and do that again.
You know, I know one thing for sure in 76 and. You couldn't get in to see him. It was impossible, almost.
It was, well, every time I went, I was very lucky to get a ticket at all.
I'm saying.
It was next to impossible to get in to see him. So I would, by 1972, I had figured it out. He's going to be there in February, and he's going to be there in August. So
correct.
I think I was 18 in 72. I think I called, like, in January for the August date.
Uh-huh.
You know, and that's how I was able to get in August of 72. You're right. I mean, his show sold out really fast.
Yeah.
Really fast.
Especially in 75 and 76. He was kind of cutting down to one show and, you know, for the most part.
Right. And one show a night for 2 weeks instead of two shows a night for 4 weeks. You're
exactly,
right.
Exactly, exactly. But, you know, I was 17 in August of 1969 when I saw Elvis, and it was distinctive. He had said, ladies and gentlemen, I got a record coming out next week. I hope you like it. It's called Suspicious Minds. Hadn't hit the radio yet. And
right.
And the next week, it hit the radio, and all hell broke loose.
Oh, you know, one of my favorite memories is hearing Suspicious Minds on stage before the record was out.
Right, that's likewise.
It was amazing.
Likewise.
The feeling I got from hearing that song and had never heard it before, and he's up there playing it for like 7.5 minutes.
Yeah.
Of course, he cut it down shortly after, but in 69, he played that song for a long time.
You know, I've told that story a million times. I heard Elvis sing Suspicious Minds before it hit the radio.
Right, and I know that feeling.
That was really, really, really
cool.
I share
that with you. I have not talked to many people who were there in August of 69, but that's absolutely the truth. He sang it on stage before the record came out.
You know, Terry, when you go off the air today, we're going to play your cut of Trying to Get to You, because most Elvis people know that that was Vernon's favorite song.
And when did you get that cut, Johnny?
I got that cut today from you, Hassan.
Oh, well, I'm darned. No, you know, the reason I sent you that, and this is important, now pay attention, because I kid you a lot, but I'm really serious right now. One of our shows in Memphis in the mid-90s had Terry Mike as the headliner. Big, big show at the Hilton Hotel in Memphis. We also had on the bill Sam Phillips.
Cool.
And nobody could come out and command the microphone like Sam Phillips, but he was out there talking about Terry Mike Jeffery, and these are his words, and I'm sure that Terry heard it. How could he not? Sam Phillips said, there's something about Terry Mike Jeffery. He has the feel of Elvis Presley, and I never forgot those words, and Sam was right. He does.
Yeah, you know.
Oh, thank you.
Terry, I was listening.
I do, as a matter of fact, I do remember him saying that, Jerry. I remember it very well.
Yeah, well, I was right. I was emceeing the show, so I was right there on the stage, and I heard every word of it, and I said, nobody has ever described Terry better than that.
Well, thank you. Thank
well, you.
You
know what? You know, Sam Phillips, he experienced that feeling for the very first time. So if he said that to you, Terry, it's more than a huge compliment. It's like.
And it really was. I couldn't believe that he said it, and I have an audio recording of that show, and he did indeed say that.
Yeah, because you know he heard that feeling for the very first time with Elvis in the studio in '54, so it's magical.
Yeah, yeah.
So now Terry, you know, heard that the new Elvis CD with the orchestra. I just played Bridge Over Troubled Water, and I was blown away. With the Royal
Philharmonic. Well, I got to tell you guys something. I think Jerry may know this, but just in case not, what I've been doing pretty much exclusively for about the last year and a half is Elvis shows with orchestras
right.
around the country. We've done Birmingham and Denver and
right.
13 in a row with the Memphis Symphony Orchestra. I just did one in Evansville, two in Evansville, Indiana. We've done Jacksonville, Florida, Knoxville, Tennessee. We've got one coming up next week in Augusta, Georgia. And
then, why aren't we hearing Seattle on this list?
Yeah.
Well I want to talk to your management team because I want to.
And Thanksgiving weekend, we've got two shows in Detroit with their symphony. Now, here's what makes that show very special. They, Graceland gives me permission to use the actual charts that Elvis's orchestra used with Joe Gershio.
Holy mackerel.
I mean, I don't know how I've managed this so far, but so far I'm the only one that they allow to use them, and I'm getting a lot of good responses, because when you listen to a recording of Elvis sing I don't know, The Wonder of You, or the or Bridge Over Troubled Waters from 1970,
correct.
And you hear that orchestration,
yeah.
That's exactly note for note what you hear when we do our show.
That's really cool.
Now,
ridiculous.
This brings to mind, I need to get up to Seattle and do this show.
Well, you're here.
Please?
Well, you know, I'm going to give you a call later, and I would love to help navigate that situation.
Sure.
Well, I would love to get up there. I did an Alaska cruise 2 years ago, and the cruise left from Seattle, and it was my first time to actually be on the ground and not in an airplane in Seattle, and I got to spend all of a day going around Seattle. It's one of my favorite cities. It was a very short time for me to be there, but my wife and I just fell in love with it, so I'd love to get up to Seattle.
Next time, Terry, you're going to stay at the Osborne Hilton.
That's right.
I would love to. That'd be great.
And Port Townsend.
Yeah.
Sounds cool, man. You know, have you listened to those cuts on the on that new Elvis album?
Oh yeah, yeah, it's fantastic. I love it.
I mean, the bridge.
You know what I love? I love Fever with the Michael Bublé.
I haven't heard it yet. I gotta listen.
Oh my gosh! You know, I've heard If I Can Dream and What Now My Love and some of the others, but I think my favorite is Fever. They've got him doing a duet with Michael Bublé and the orchestra playing behind them.
It's
gotta
be
fascinating
epic.
What they've done with that arrangement.
Wow. Do you perform If I Can Dream?
Of course. Of course he does.
That's my favorite
Elvis
song.
He's on YouTube.
I haven't seen it.
He's on YouTube with an orchestra, and I watched it today.
Well, I'm just saying that's quite the undertaking, that song.
You know,
do you enjoy singing it?
Oh, my God.
Very much?
I love singing If I Can Dream.
Yeah. What's your favorite song to sing?
Oh boy.
My favorite song to sing is probably How Great Thou Art.
Oh, yeah.
But when someone asks me what my favorite Elvis song is, I always say Suspicious Minds, and I always say why, and it's the story we just shared, and
yeah.
That is I got to experience that song in person before it was ever available on a record.
That's
I thought
magic.
You might say One Track Heart.
One Track Heart, I love One.
Why is that significant?
I love One Track Heart.
From Rastabout?
He recorded it 2 years before he met Elvis in Vegas in 69.
Oh, that's a great song. It's a great song.
You know what's funny is there's a lot of Elvis songs that I just love that were never hits. Songs like Tender Feeling from
Kissing Cousins
and Big Love, Big Heartache from Rastabout.
Oh, yeah. Big Love.
Yeah, I love that song. And I Don't Want To from Girls, Girls, Girls.
Oh, that's beautiful. You know, he was in such great voice in Girls, Girls, Girls. It's incredible.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I Don't Want To.
and Because of Love. I love that song.
That's
because
a great
of
song.
Girls,
because
girls,
of
girls.
Love. You know,
and the Kid Galahad soundtrack.
Oh yeah,
I love the Kid Galahad. I love Home Is Where the Heart Is and
Home Is
King
Where
of the Whole
Heart
World.
Is.
And I Got Lucky. Just a great soundtrack.
Can you imagine us guys out for the night?
Well, I think we could have a good time.
Yeah.
So look, I have a question. Do you ever just wander into a karaoke bar and blow their minds? I love it. I go to karaoke bars just to wait for people like you to come in. Do you ever do that?
Is that right?
Oh, yeah.
You know what? I don't know that I have ever. Maybe once or twice over the years, but nothing is coming right to mind. But that would be fun, yeah.
You know, my fear of the karaoke bars is the song being in the wrong key. You know,
right,
and you know
right.
That
well,
you know, Terry.
You can tell the host to change the key.
Yeah, but you're not sure where that machine
Whitney
is.
Houston has actually done it herself. Just walked into a karaoke bar, did one of her songs, and walked out. That's so cool.
Well, Terry doesn't really need a karaoke bar, though, because he is a musician who plays about a half a dozen different instruments, so he can accompany himself.
That would be rad.
I saw you playing piano on If I Can Dream on YouTube. That was cool.
Wow.
And then another thing that's cool that you do is when you're on Sirius Radio, and you got something coming up on November 24th, I know that, or something similar, 25th.
Yes, November 25th.
Okay.
I'll be back on Elvis Radio at 10:30 that morning, 10:30 Central Standard Time.
I've heard you on Elvis Radio, and you come in the studio with the guitar and kick out Separate Ways or songs like that. It's amazing.
Well, thank you. I have a lot of fun with Elvis Radio. I've been doing that now for about seven years,
mm-hmm.
And I love what we're able to do on there. I just play a little bit of a song, and then the DJ we try to segue into Elvis's version of the same song,
right.
and it works pretty good.
Whose idea was it to come up with Guadalajara and all the movie titles?
You know what's funny about that is we were, let's see, it was during Elvis Week about 4 years ago, five maybe. I had an audience that was kind of doing a, they were trying to do a little stump the band on TMJ, you know. So I'm playing stuff like Wolf Call. And,
oh, yeah.
And we're going to move. And just rubbernecking and just whatever. And somebody hollers out Guadalajara. Well,
yeah.
I can play the melody, I can play the chords and sing the melody, but I can't speak Spanish and I don't know what he's saying. So I just as a joke, I said I'd come closer to singing all the movie titles to the melody of Guadalajara, and,
right.
and so I did. When I was a kid, I don't know why, but I memorized the list of Elvis's movies in order.
Okay.
And I could just rattle it off. So I thought, well, I'll just rattle it off and try to make it fit the rhythm and the melody of the song. And it by the skin of my teeth, it worked.
Why don't you demonstrate just a little bit of that? Live.
Well,
live
gosh,
on the radio.
I don't have a guitar handy, but I remember saying, Guadalajara, 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 love me tender, loving you, jailhouse rock, King Creole. Yeah, blues, flaming star, wild in the country, blue Hawaii, follow that dream, kid Galahad, and girls, girls, girls.
It happened at the World's Fair.
What is going on? What just happened?
That was cool.
That was really cool, but
wow. Isn't that great?
Yeah, do it again.
Guadalajara is one of my most favorite movie songs he ever did. You know, it was a magical song for him to pull that song off.
You know what? That is something else for someone like Elvis that was never educated in foreign languages to rattle that off like that and do it well. He did it eloquently. He didn't just get by. He sounds great.
Yeah.
You know, singing those words on that song.
Terry, I'm out of time. I got to get you back on the show so I can sing Guadalajara for you.
it would be an honor.
Tell our listeners again, real quick, about you, what's going on with you on Elvis Radio. We got about 30 seconds.
What's coming up on Elvis Radio?
Well, yeah, the 20, yeah. What we just talked about.
November 25th, I'll be on Elvis Radio at 10:30 in the morning, Central Standard Time. And I'm doing a salute to the movie Harum Scarum.
I like good soundtrack.
It does have some good songs, and we're going to be paying tribute to that movie, and we'll be performing some of the songs on the radio, on Elvis Radio.
We're going to get you back on the radio, Jerry. I love you.
Okay, buddy.
You're listening to Viva ENT Seattle, ladies and gentlemen. Terry, are you still on the line?
I am.
I am still here.
Guadalajara, Guadalajara. Hi, everybody. This is Johnny from Viva Productions. I want to tell you a little bit about Elite Limousine. Right now, we have prom specials for 10-passenger stretch limousines, only $90 an hour. That's right, $90 an hour with a four-hour minimum, 206-542-5733. Go to viva-productions.com for pricing.
Life's a celebration. Grand Event Rentals makes your event their top priority. They are your full-service, special event, and party rental provider, supplying everything you need from start to finish. Their professional sales team and event staff work with you to create your dream event. With every event, Grand Event Rentals customers' needs are the most important. Whether you're planning an intimate outdoor wedding or an elaborate black tie gala, the Grand Event Rentals specialists make great pride in providing our event planning experience to help create an unforgettable event. Please go and visit the Bellevue Showroom, Grand Event Rentals, or make a one-on-one appointment. Talk to them. They're trained, they're knowledgeable, they're event specialists, and they are going to take you through step-by-step everything that you need to make your day a success. Call Grand Event Rentals. Their number is 425-462-7368, or go to grandeventrentalslaw.com.